Four Pillar Sports, a podcast for sports fans, made by sports fans. Join Chris and Randy every week as they dive deep into football, basketball, baseball, and professional wrestling. Catch Four Pillar Sports on all major platforms. And remember, keep on talking sports.
Sergeant and Mrs. Smith, you are going to love this house.
Is that a tub in the kitchen?
There's no field manual for finding the right home. But when you do, USAA Homeowners Insurance can help protect it the right way. Restrictions apply.
Walmart Plus members save on meeting up with friends. Save on having them over for dinner with free delivery with no hidden fees or markups. That's groceries plus napkins plus that vegetable chopper to make things a bit easier. Plus, members save on gas to go meet them in their neck of the woods. Plus, when you're ready for the ultimate sign of friendship, start a show together with your included Paramount Plus subscription. Walmart Plus members save on this plus so much more. Start a 30-day free trial at walmartplus.com. Paramount Plus, essential plan only. Separate registration required. See Walmart Plus terms and conditions.
Age of Radio.
Oi! I brought those fellas in again. They're doing their thing, so they come down here to use this room, eh?
How many fellas did you bring this time?
Well, it's the same two fucking guys. It's the fat one and it's the other fat one.
Oh, all right. What are we going to do? Hey, you won't fuck up the studio before they show up?
I already shat in a chair. I don't know why we're so mean to them. I mean, they do pay us money.
Wait. That wasn't a Reese's cup?
No.
Oh, fuck me. Well, it's still delicious.
You're getting into some very deep toilet humor, and I don't approve of it.
It's not humor. I had the whole thing.
That's toilet truth, as that is.
We're just a couple of truthers.
Just a couple of toilet fucking truthers, bye.
Fucking toilet truthers. I think that. Oh shit! Get out of here!
Oh, there's two guys and there's a lady. Get out!
Get out! Get out of here.
Get out of here, you dirty guys, you British people that we rent this room from, for reasons that I never understood.
I don't understand why we got such horrible landlords, Jason.
I know, but I can't help but love them.
Can't help but love them. They're lovable.
Lovable stereotypes.
And I already said that your name is Jason.
And I believe I will indicate that your name is Brendan.
Well, thank you for indicating so. This is a podcast called For Screen.
And Gunter.
And on this podcast, Jason, what in the shit do we do?
Well, we do lots of things, Brendan. Traditionally, we had watched BFI films, but we finished those, and so now we're watching the Empire list of British movies and filling in our gaps post-2000 to determine, ultimately, the greatest British films of all time. But this week, we're not doing that. We're indulging in some self-love and self-care, and we are doing a Brit pick. You know it. You love it. Here we are. And, Brendan, this is a special one.
It is a special one, so we're going to reveal that in just a second. But before we do that, Jason, we should mention that the movie that we're going to be talking about is 2005's Pride and Prejudice. Saying the theme.
Sometimes a woman has pride, and sometimes she's prejudiced against things that are different than her. But ultimately, it comes down to the fact that what a woman truly wants is an emotionally unavailable man that she can break through to, and then, I guess, get his inheritance and live off the land with peasants farming it. So what you want to do is you want to get your pride and you want to get your prejudice and you're going to want to put them together and you're going to want to make a lie. If I turned into Manny Patinkin at the end there a bit, if I do say so myself.
It's a beautiful song.
Thank you.
Yes, that theme song can only indicate one thing, and that is that we are talking about the 2005 Pride and Prejudice directed by Joe Wright. No, it was a total coincidence. I did not mean to talk about two of those in a row, but here we are. But Jason, I see a checkbook on the counter. I think someone's joining us here who owes you a bit of money.
Well, it's us. Owes us a bit of money. But ladies and gentlemen, for the first time joining us on the podcast, top rated commenter and fan, one Sharon Horwatt. Sharon, thank you for joining us today on For Screen and Country.
And Country.
Hey, what's up, bitches?
Wow.
Oh, aggressive, out of the gate.
Rich is coming in hot. Oh, Sharon, you said, don't you dare make me watch this movie that I hate.
Definitely said that. How fucking dare you make me sit through this garbage piece of cinema that I definitely haven't seen about 100 times.
And for those of you wondering, the occasional audio, we are having a little bit of audio issues, but that's because Sharon is hooked up to the CCTV feed. Yeah. We unfortunately, Skype has taken a full leave of absence from our podcast over protests of Jason's singing in recent episodes.
Yes, absolutely.
And we are forced to make do with what we got. But please don't tweet us about it.
No. And also be aware that she is in an area that is currently being threatened by gangs of tornadoes. So she may have to leave at some point.
Gangs of tornadoes?
They're organized now. They have they've gotten smart. We got smart fucking tornadoes, Brendan, and it's a real problem.
So I know Crips and Bloods. So what would the tornado gangs be?
They'd be the Winds.
That's it?
Yeah. No, it's the Winds. Their battle cry would be break wind because they love potty humor.
Oh, who doesn't?
Yeah.
Sharon, you suggested this Pride and or Prejudice film. Tell us about your clear love of this. I mean, say this movie, but everything about this, really.
So I don't remember when I saw it. I definitely didn't see it in theaters. Because I think I was a little too young for it at the time. I definitely got it from the library, like this specific version. And then, like, it's just really, really good. So I just kept watching it over and over. And I've seen, like, a ton of stage productions. There's actually the Shakespeare Company that's in my city is doing a production that they started doing at the right before the pandemic hit. And they brought it back because it was really popular. And they were like, hey, our thing got interrupted. So let's do it again. And then my high school did a production of it. And then when I was in college, my theater group did a production there. And when I was in high school, even we had to read it for school. So I actually had to write papers on it. I watched the Colin Firth version when I was doing that. I've rewatched that a bunch of times. There've been literally hundreds of these versions of this story for obvious reasons. It's lasted long enough. Oh my god.
I have a quick question. In the Colin Firth version, does Mr. Firth play Mr. Darcy?
He does. Oh. Yes,
because I when I went to watch this, I for in the back of my head I'm like, is Colin Firth in this? And like, no, it was not.
No, that was, I think, the miniseries version he did with Jennifer Ely, or as I like to call her, not Meryl Streep. because she looks so much like her. That was like the thing that made him like super famous.
And Jason, just because I like to compare and contrast here, tell us about your storied history with Pride and Prejudice.
I literally, I knew it existed. It always seemed like especially when I was a teenager, and I was like, oh, that's a chick novel. You know, I mean, I didn't read like 19th century. Because I tried to read Wuthering Heights because we were supposed to read it in grade 10, and that kind of turned me off that type of writing. Though I give Wuthering Heights credit. I've always said this about it. When you read Wuthering Heights, and I don't know, maybe this was the copy I had, but you can smell the damp moldiness of Northern England. She's very good at portraying that. I just don't like it.
It's about a lot of people being like, hey, what if we were terrible for each other?
What if we were all terrible and sad?
Yeah, and I guess for me, I knew of the book. I knew of this movie. I don't know if I knew specifically of other versions of it, but I mean, I'm not a dummy. I know they exist.
Well, we watched Sense and Sensibility, and we knew that Jane Austen obviously is very famous and has had a lot of movies.
Stone Cold Jane Austen. We all know her.
Jane Austen, our favorite.
And I think I was confused too about the Colin Firth thing. I actually thought he was going to be in this too, and I think my confusion came from Bridget Jones's Diary because I think he plays Mr. Darcy in that movie.
Mr. Darcy in that version.
Which,
and then
now I get it. I get it.
Wait, so Bridget Jones' Diary is a version of this?
It is, yeah.
Really? Yeah, that's a good reason. I'm going to have to watch that.
Now, what about Bridget Jones's diary, The Edge of Reason?
That is supposed to be based off of one of her books, I think. Really?
I believe it's based on Fight Club.
I think it's based off of Persuasion.
Oh, okay.
It's not quite, but you know, it's similar from what I remember.
I'm sorry to be the bearer of bad news, Jason, that it's not based on a Chuck Palahniuk book.
Damn it.
So Pride and Prejudice, we're all coming into this with the exact same recognition of the of the work.
Yep, I definitely didn't overextend myself and read the book again and watch like three other versions plus this and just watch it right before we started recording.
You are the best. You are the best. This is the kind of dedication we need in Guest Bread, and she's setting a precedent that Steve and Izzy are going to have to live up to if they ever come back. They're going to have to watch multiple versions of the movie that we want to watch.
I mean, Jason, if you remember correctly, we did make them watch both Zhivagos.
Yeah, that's true. That was a horrible torture to inflict upon them, the second one, anyways.
And one of them starred Keira Knightley. Speaking of Keira Knightley.
Oh, that's right. That's where we almost got arrested because we saw Keira Knightley's underage boobs.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Forgot about that. Yeah. I wanted to expunge that out of my brain.
That happened in...
2003?
That happened in...
2002?
No, I was going to say that happened in like a couple of movies. That was like in the movie The Hole that happens too.
Wow.
To her or just someone
Keira in Keira Knightley.
Oh, wow. God. Why?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, stop it.
Different rules in England.
I don't want it. I want
to grown up, then you gotta show your titties.
I don't want it. No. Please be 18 first.
That's what we say to you folks, to our audience. If you're gonna show your tits on screen, please
be 18
first.
At least 18, please.
This message is brought to you by the Screening Country Advisory Council.
And not by the director of Jeepers Creepers.
No.
The more you know.
So, guys, this thing, I don't know if you know, I don't know if Sharon knows, but this thing's based on a book.
Wait, what?
And
How come no one told me that?
Actually, you know what? I am actually fascinated. Jason usually, like, sums up the plot real quick for us at the beginning, and I would love to hear his attempt at it.
So, you got all these ladies. There's, like, five of them. They got a mom, played by Brenda Bledin, who's amazing. And all Brenda Bledin wants.
Their names.
Well, let's see. There is Lydia. There is Elizabeth. There is June? Judy?
What's the author's name?
Oh, that's Jane Austen. Jane.
Yeah, there you go.
Jane, Lydia, Elizabeth. We've got Destiny and Sparkles.
You definitely have one of them as a pet.
Gracie?
No. Nope. No, it's Kitty and Mary.
Oh,
are the other two.
Kitty and Mary. Well, they don't get as much screen time.
Most versions cut out Kitty for obvious reasons.
I saw Lydia in this movie and I was like, oh, wow, I know her. Where's she from? And then my wife looked her up and goes, oh, it's Jenna Malone. I'm like, oh, yeah, Sucker Punch.
Jesus.
So, all right, Jason, what happens next? We're focusing on Elizabeth. She's a young lady. She is like so many young aristocratic young ladies. She wants to be married at some point, but she's also headstrong and she wants to find love because her dad has told her, you got to find love. You can't just marry for whatever reason. You got to find love. But her mom is much more pragmatic. She just wants to get her kids all married off because in those days, that was the greatest thing for a mom was marrying off your daughters. So I guess that meant she didn't have to worry about them anymore, right? And that's what every mother wants, not to worry about their children. So Elizabeth eventually encounters a Mr. Darcy, played by a dime store Clive Owen. And I say that with love because I really like the guy. He's fantastic. But at first, I'm just like, that looks like Clive Owen, sort of. So they meet Mr. Darcy. Mr. Darcy, if I had to describe him, is basically a proto-Spock. I feel like Spock may have taken some... where he's like very analytical and he's like, he feels very serious and there's not a lot of humor in him. But Elizabeth is very funny and she loves to tease him, right? And they start to kind of develop a little bit of a spark between them, even though she doesn't really like him. It's one of those things where women have to understand that sometimes if they don't like him, you should listen to my other podcast, Hasten with Jason, where we talk about all these issues. But yeah, anyway, so love. Some people get married, some stuff happens, and then eventually Darcy and Elizabeth fall in love and get married. The end.
God save the queen.
God save the screen. No.
Okay.
Now, Sharon, how would you describe this movie in a much better way? Can you give me a précis?
But make sure you include love, 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 love.
Blah, blah, blah.
Okay. So, it's about the Bennett sisters because none of them, because their parents, you know, failed to produce a male heir, they are sort of, their mother is making sure that they get married. There's a man named Bingley who comes into town. He's like living in the country for the season. Jane really likes him. And then he just up and leaves all of a sudden. He ghosts her. He 1812 ghosts her. For plot shenanigan reasons, she ends up crossing paths with Mr. Darcy again, a man that she did not like before, and then continues to not like when she finds out that Darcy is part of the reason why Jane and her definitely was going to get married to person. The reason that she, or Darcy ends up being the reason that Jane and Bingley ended up not getting married, and she's like, I'm fucking mad at this dude. He's an asshole. And then he's like, by the way, I love you. And she's like, wait, what the fuck's going on? And then, you know, la la la, la la la, blah blah blah, yada yada yada, love love love. They end up getting together. The end.
So what a cast in this, folks. What a cast. We've got Donald Sutherland, first and foremost, as Mr. Bennett, the patriarch of the family. Also, I love that they're in that period where everything is so formal that Mrs. Bennett calls him Mr. Bennett. I don't think that we ever hear his first name.
I don't think you ever learn it.
I thought his first, I thought his first name was Mr.
Yeah, he's like Sergeant Driver.
And her name is Mrs.
Yeah, it's like Mr.
One guy I got to point out, I didn't actually note the actor's name. Perhaps you can help me, Brendan, here. But is the gentleman that plays a Vicar Collins. Credit to this guy, because Collins comes across as such a dead-eyed weirdo.
Oh, Tom Hollander?
Tom Hollander, yes. He's wonderful.
Yeah, he is a dick.
He's, he's such a dick. And he's so self-important and pompous. And he's so boring when he's reading the sermon. And he, of course, the only interesting part is when he mistakenly says intercourse instead of the intercourse.
Yeah, he's it, when Tom Holland is acting more Tom Holland, right. He's Tom Hollander.
Absolutely, 100%. Wow, this guy should have played Spider-Man.
Ba-ding, ba-zing, done.
I do think it's funny because Mr. Collins is straight up, he's one of the worst characters in the book. And if you see the miniseries, the guy who plays him is much more, he has... Just in general, he has this, like, just this pompous energy, but the guy who plays him in the miniseries has what I like to call Weasley, a nasty little weasel. To put it more bluntly, he has Ted Cruz energy.
Oh, yeah, that's, you nailed it. And
I think some of it could just be because I really like Tom Hollander as an actor. Mm. He has this charisma that makes me not completely... like want to like pick him up and then just like punt him off of a bridge that down like the nearest hole.
I get that. But
he's the worst.
I don't know him from anything. I what else has he been in?
Spider-Man.
He was in, well, he's going to be in The Loop, which I know you haven't gotten to yet, but he's in that. I think he might be the prime minister, but I can't remember for sure. The thing I know him from is Rev.
Now, when you say he's in Rev, are you referring to the carbonated alcoholic beverage that people used to drink when I was in university 20 years ago?
No, there was a TV show that he did where he played a reverend at a church in England, and his wife is played by Olivia Colman.
Yes.
And one of his supervisors, I can't remember, it's one of the leaders that he has to talk to, is played by Ralph Fiennes in a couple of episodes. It was pretty dope.
We love Ralph Fiennes from our favorite movie, The English Patient, number one on the BFI list.
Go fuck yourself, Jason. Okay, well, let's get into a little bit of the nitty-gritty of this whole thing, because I think we all got to agree that when you adapt something, especially something as beloved as this, into a film, you do encounter a lot of criticism, a lot of, you know, a lot of praise too, but a lot of criticism about this thing isn't perfect like the book. This thing is different. Why did they change this? Why is this different? And like, I mean, I think Sharon, I think you probably know the most about this, but like, what, like, do you think, and I don't even know, well, we'll get into it later, what the some of the actual reaction was, but like, do you think this is like a faithful adaptation? Obviously there's going to be differences, but do you think overall it is faithful to the source material?
Oh yeah, 100%. Really the best thing that I can say comparing it to the miniseries, which is just like, it is the book on film. I would say that this is about as faithful of an adaptation. It's just on fast forward, for lack of a better word. It's like, there are certain things that definitely do happen in the book, but it's like, we're just going to go super, super fast because we only have about 2 hours and 10 minutes and we got to get done. I think Mrs. Bennett has another sister who is not married, that is also cut for time. And then Charlotte, Lizzie's friend, has a sister that visits Charlotte with her.
Okay. One of the things I find interesting, speaking of Charlotte, I think she's an interesting character because she is like one of the more, I think, realistic characters of the time, because for her, a marriage is an incredibly pragmatic thought. And from her perspective, because that's the same case actually that Collins makes to Elizabeth. He's like, look, here's the pragmatic reasons why this is going to work. I'm a vicar. You're going to have a house to run. You're going to do this. You're going to do that. And she's like, but no, I want to love. I want to be loved. But Charlotte is the type of woman that is like, no, look, it's 1812 and I'm a woman. I don't have a whole lot of agency in this world. I'm going to do what's best for me. And this makes the most pragmatic sense in my situation. I thought that was an interesting contrast.
Yeah, I think I'd have to agree with that. And I think it's extra interesting how it's done in the movie, because in the book and other versions, it's mostly like she just kind of finds out secondhand. Charlotte doesn't actually come to her and tell her the situation. She's just like, oh yeah, I heard Charlotte's getting married. Why? She's smarter than that. And it's like, yeah, she is that smart.
Yeah.
She knows that she doesn't, even though she is about, you know, she's nice looking enough. She's poorer. She doesn't necessarily have a lot of options. She's old at 27.
What a hag.
Thanks for that. Thanks for making me feel better about myself.
Well, as you know, Jason and I have covered many British films, and if someone is like, well, pushing 26, they're considered an old hag.
What was the movie, the kitchen sink drama with the lady that
Taste
was like,
of Honey.
Taste of Honey, where she was like 40 and she's like, oh my God, she's like a senior citizen.
Yeah. put her in a fucking home, give her a bus discount.
Exactly. The poor women. Yeah.
And you know what's extra funny about that particular scene is that, I'm sure you're going to get into this, but Emma Thompson wrote that scene.
Oh.
Uncredited.
Huh. I didn't know that. Did you know that, Brendan?
I thought you meant In a Taste of Honey.
No. Sorry.
You went back in time.
No, I think she would have been too young at that point. Yeah. Emma Thompson did a couple of like punch-ups on the script, and she specifically rewrote the scene where Charlotte tells Lizzie why she's doing what she's doing. And I think, what was the other one? It's the scene where Lizzie gets the letter about what happened to Lydia. And that was the other one, which I find hard to believe because, and I'm sure you might have thought this, but the scene near the end of the movie where they find out that Bingley is coming to the house and they're running around like, oh my God, be natural, is almost exactly like what happens at the end of Sense and Sensibility.
It did remind me a lot of this. All of that reminded me of the ending, especially the fact that they don't actually kiss at the end.
Yeah.
I noted was interesting. But then I also
thought... We have that really cool shot, too, like where it's like their heads come together and we get the sun and it's a wonderful highlight. It kind of actually reminded me, Brendan, of Artanawat. There was that scene in Artanawat with the sun, and I really like that.
I was going to say that I wonder if the kiss just didn't happen because Matthew Macfayden was like quite a bit older than Keira Knightley and it would be weird. I don't know.
I think he would have taken that opportunity, Brendan.
I'm not saying he wouldn't. I don't know who Matthew Macfayden is, Jason.
You're saying Keira Knightley's a prude? She's shown her tits for years, Brendan.
I'm not saying the actors. I'm thinking that the filmmakers were like, oh, he looks like, I don't know. He looked like 15 years older than Keira Knightley.
Sure.
I'll look it up.
I would say, too, I mean, maybe there's because of Sense and Sensibility, sorry, of Pride and Prejudice, of the whole oeuvre really being set in this particular time where everybody is so extremely formal and everything is so regimented and expected, like in the movie itself, like having that scene of them coming together without kissing feels like a reflection of the modesty of the era, perhaps. Is that right? Crazy?
Well, I think I did read that they did film a kiss, but they just ended up using it. The same as Sense and Sensibility. They filmed the kiss between Emma Thompson and Hugh Grant.
And Matthew McFadden ruined all the takes, like William Shatner did in the original Star Trek, to make sure that they had the scene of Uhura and Kirk kissing. So yeah, Star Trek is awesome. Thank you.
So I just looked it up. He is 11 years old.
I knew he was a lot older than her.
So anyway. How much older are you than Mariah, Brendan?
5 years. Oh,
I'm 6 years older than Katrina.
And there was I think at the time she was 20.
No, she was like 18, I think, at the time.
No, so when it came out, she was 20.
Yeah.
Sorry, yeah, right. She was born 85.
She was 20 when she came out, but she was like 18 or 19 when they started.
Right, which is like fine and legal, but still a large difference. Yeah.
didn't want to be looked on like that guy from 2025.
You know, her being married to Matthew McFadden in this still isn't as bad as when she gets married to Chiwetel Ejiofor in Love Actually, because she's literally 17. Yuck.
But other than that, that movie has no issues and it ages like fine wine.
Absolutely no problems. It's just like Forrest Gump. There's nothing wrong with it whatsoever.
Here's a question. I have a question for you, Sharon. So we got Lydia. Yes. Lydia is 15. She runs away with Wickham, who we haven't talked about. Wickham is a soldier,
dick.
An officer, a dick. He grew up with Darcy and claimed that he was denied his birthright, I guess, to as a cushy gig as a priest because Darcy was a dick. And then Darcy tells us that no, that wasn't the case. He just wanted the money and then he gambled it away. Who's telling the truth?
Darcy, duh.
Okay, he's definitely telling the truth.
Yes, he's definitely telling the truth.
Jason, so this, wait, you didn't wait. You thought he
did
was.
Did you think that he was lying?
I thought that maybe at the end of the movie, maybe ultimately Darcy was the villain.
Well, hold on.
I thought I was reading between the lines.
Wait a minute. What?
Jason, stop for a second. Stop the podcast.
Excuse
me. There was a moment in the. Now that was the moment where she realized that he helped. Like he ultimately told Bingley not to go for her sister Jane, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But then she figured out that he got her back. Yeah. And that he actually paid sure. Whatever Wickham's like military compensation, whatever that was, so that he and Lydia could be wed.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I don't think like, why would he lie about that?
No, I'm not saying necessarily he does through this. I'm saying in my mind, I'm like, is this guy a secret villain that we don't see? But that's just me being crazy, perhaps. But thinking, maybe Wickham's a stand-up British soldier, an officer, and a gentleman. And obviously he is, because he married a 15-year-old girl that he stole away.
Every Jane Austen fan right now, Jason, is so mad at you. Including the one on our podcast. Jason's like, you know what? I'm just going to say it. Elizabeth was the villain.
Yeah.
Okay, so ultimately then comparing this with the book there, like you said, it's just kind of a fast forward. There's some stuff here and there, but it's a faithful adaptation. I want to talk about the performances a little bit in this movie too, because I think it's really interesting that we just talked about atonement last week. Again, yes. I can't stress this enough. It was a coincidence.
Not planned.
Not planned at all. But I think it's really interesting. Keira Knightley's performance style is so different in this movie. Because, I mean, last week she talked about how she kind of watched movies like In Which We Serve and Brief Encounter to, like, study the, like, naturalistic kind of acting styles. Mm. Whereas in this, I think she's obviously a lot more bubbly. She's kind of, like, you know, upbeat more. But, yeah, she's a little bit of, like, a fun demeanor to her, I guess. I'm just saying, like, I think a worse actor would just be like, oh, another period piece. I'll just do my thing. But, I think it's worth pointing out that she's really good.
I really like how she is in this movie. And one of the things that I really like about it is that it feels grounded. Like, ultimately, like, this is the sort of text that I imagine is very easy to get into, like, almost overwrote melodrama. You know, you can get very like, oh, Mr. Darcy, blah, 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 blah. You can go that like super formal route. And they do that, but like she feels like naturalistic when she's doing it. Everything she says feels like somebody's actually talking rather than somebody doing a character from a book. And I appreciate it. It's like when you could do Shakespeare naturalistically and how That's difficult tough. That is. That is very tough with the text. And similarly here, and all the credit to her because she's fantastic. And not everybody does that in the movie, but most of them do, I would say.
Because bad movies are one thing. Bad Shakespeare movies, it's rough. Yeah.
It kills rough. Sheep.
Yes.
That's from one.
They kill a sheep?
No, there's Kenneth Branagh did an adaptation of Love's Labor's Lost, and there's literally a part. There's that line where he says he looks out the window, a sheep walks by, and then a clearly fake sheep is replaced, and then it keels over, and then he goes, "It kills sheep."
Yeah, that movie is terrible.
I wish it was better. I really wish it was better.
It's a Shakespeare adaptation into a musical.
Wow.
All the songs are like old standards.
Mm-hmm.
Like they didn't actually write songs.
Fly me to the moon.
I wish. So back to Pride and Prejudice, 2005.
Oh, anyway.
I was going to say, yeah. So some of the other performances, I mean, you guys already talked about a little bit about Brenda Blethyn, who I think is such a difficult character to play, right? Because she's got this, I mean, I think at times you kind of find her obnoxious and you're like, all right, like that's enough already. But she's also like, ultimately at the end of the day, she's doing all this because she wants her family to stay afloat. Yeah. Like she wants her daughters to have money. She wants her family to have money. You know, she doesn't want to end up on the streets, although I guess there weren't really streets at the time, but you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But
I mean, there were streets, Brendan. It wasn't that long ago. There's been streets since the Romans, at least.
Well, they weren't good streets. Listen, let me tell you something.
The fucking Roman roads still exist, Brendan. In Britain, you can go and see Roman roads.
I'll tell you something about the Roman roads. They were horrible.
And covered in feces.
Well, covered in feces.
That's true.
As Sharon has said three times to you now, Jason.
So I'm sorry, Sharon.
Comedy rule of three.
That's right. You're correct, because in England they didn't figure out. It's funny how we as society didn't figure out until the 1800s that, hey, if you didn't shit where you lived, then you're going to be healthier.
Yeah, who would have thunk it?
Who would have thunk it?
Who's done something that comes out of your asshole is dangerous for your health to be that close to your face? Yeah, it's weird.
They were way more asshole positive back in the 1800s.
They didn't asshole shame people.
That's right. No, they didn't.
No poop shaming.
I think it is very funny because really depending on who you get to play Mrs. Bennet, she can be obnoxious. They really played up in the miniseries. She is just super like hyper fixated. She talks about her nerves. She's very excitable all the time. And I think because they got such a great actress to play her, it's partially in the script and partially her that like they really just make her seem like a normal person who's just, you know,
she's a mom who cares, and she's doing everything she can to make sure that her daughters are set. Once every single one of her daughters is married off and set, then she can fucking relax for once in her life.
One scene that stood out for me for her though is when she has Jane going to see Mr. Bingley, and Jane wants to take a carriage, and she says, no, take a horse, because she knows it's about to rain, she's going to get stuck there, and they'll have to spend the night together and get to know each other a bit more. Maybe then they'll be closer to getting married. I was like, you calculating genius.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, she does some other stuff in terms of like just little asides that she has where it's like, rude, where like she mentions at the dance, like when they first meet Bingley, they mention something about how Charlotte Lucas is an agreeable person. She's like, yes, it's just such a shame she's so plain looking. And it's like, Mom, how fucking dare you? That's my best friend.
She also does tell Collins, because he wants Jane at first, played by Rosamund Pike, and she tells Collins, well, Jane is unfortunately spoken for, but you can have my second prettiest daughter.
And he's like, yes, that's an agreeable alternative.
Yeah, that is satisfactory to me. Like,
I mean, for him as a vicar, he's got to have a wife, because otherwise it's going to look suspicious.
Yeah.
Well, that and his, you know, his patroness told him to, because, you know.
And his thing, too, Collins is like, he because he's gonna inherit the house. So that's why they're like, oh, one of the daughters needs to marry him, and then ultimately doesn't one of the no who does he marry?
He marries Charlotte.
Oh, Charlotte.
Charlotte. Oh, right. Okay.
He very much reminds me, especially like just in general, of have you ever seen Late Night with Seth Meyers?
Oh yeah.
Okay. Did you ever see? Was it Andy Samberg had a sketch that never made it to air that he wanted to do called the "You Want to Come With" guy?
Yes.
So. His marriage proposal reminds me of that. Just like, want to get married? No. Okay, cool. So you want to get married? No, I really don't. Cool. So wasted. You want to get married, though? No, I don't.
Jason, have you seen this sketch?
I haven't seen that one, no.
It's like, yeah, literally, that's literally what it is. It's just Andy Samberg standing there just being like, you want to hit the hay? And Seth Meyers is like, no, I don't need to go to the bathroom. He's like, okay, cool. But you want to hit the head though? No, I'm good. So wasted.
Yeah, just throw in some incel nonsense, and that's basically it.
It's so ridiculous. I'm like, oh, I wonder why that got cut. Yeah. It's one joke, but it's great.
I literally quote it all the time.
It's like 10 minutes long. Anywho, yeah.
It oh, is 100% that.
Also wanted to highlight Rosamund Pike as Jane Bennett, because I think she's kind of underrated, doesn't really get talked about as much. Mm-hmm. But I think Rosamund Pike's performance, she's so good at the subtleties, because I think that character, that character, like we learn, is not great at showing her actual emotions. She's shy. She's kind of a lot more reserved than Elizabeth. That's like, that's fun with their relationship, because Elizabeth's so like out there and Jane is very internal. But I like, it's, I always say like in movies like this, we talked about some of them before, Jason, where a character, you have to play a character that's like not showing their emotions that much, but you have to be able to tell that they're hiding them.
Yeah.
Like, I think that's such a difficult thing to do, like difficult acting thing to do. Because if you do it wrong, it just looks like you're a robot.
I was going to say, yeah. And back to the Spock example, Leonard Nimoy and Zachary Quinto and Ethan Peck are all actors that have managed to do that and have a character that is supposed to be sensibly emotionless, but still being able to have that shine through the exterior. And it's an impressive feat. And again, all respect to Matthew Macfayden and the world for really pulling it off.
Oh, Matthew Macfayden does the same thing too. Yeah, 100%. And Rosamund Pike doesn't stab Doogie Howser in this one. So that was something else.
Oh, you're talking about Rosamund Pike. That's why I was confused.
And she doesn't tie up Peter Dinklage and leave him in a ditch somewhere, also naked.
Oh, poor Peter Dinklage.
Yeah, that's an I Care a Lot, a movie I don't care a lot about.
But I want to see it, and you told me the ending.
God, that's not the end. That's not the end. That's just something that happens in the movie at some point.
Okay.
Sharon, you need to replace Gene Shalit in the public consciousness.
I care a lot, more like I don't care at all.
Lol.
This gone girl was gone before the ending credits started.
Girl. Gone girl.
I want to give a special shout out because we've seen
thank
her
you.
Things before.
Thank you. No, I appreciate it, Jason. Thank you very much for the shout out. You know, I try hard every week. I love that you're finally showing the love, and thank you. God save the queen.
Okay, shut up. Listen, I got to tell you, I'm really happy. Penelope Wilton is in this. Of course, yes. Miss Crawley from Downton Abbey. She's been in some other movies we've seen. She plays the aunt. She only has a small scene.
Sean's mom.
Right, that's right. She was Sean's mom. That's where
I was shocked. That's where you didn't go at first.
I didn't think of it because I just see Mrs. Crawley in my head, unfortunately.
Right.
But yeah, no, she's great in this. She doesn't have a whole lot, but I enjoy seeing her in these sorts of movies because I feel like this is what she's destined to do.
Yeah.
Harriet Jones, former prime minister.
That's right, on Doctor Who.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Okay, I do remember her from. Not that I've watched a massive amount of Doctor Who, but I do remember that.
Okay, so. Brendan, you haven't watched any Downton Abbey, right?
Not a second.
Okay. Jason.
Yes.
So you remember how Lady Mary has sex with a guy in the first season and then he dies in her bed?
Ah, yes.
Okay. So I think they explain that he had a heart condition that they didn't know about and they died. He died because of that. So I didn't hear that line. So when we watched it, I was like, almost exactly like what happens in A Winter's Tale, to bring it back to that. I was like, oh my God, he died? Does she have a deadly vagina?
Because if you don't know, Jason, in Winter's Tale, Colin Farrell kills a girl with his dick.
Yep.
Wow. God damn.
And as a result, every single time, Lady Mary would have to be like, I have to tell you something. Me or my dad would go, I have a deadly vagina.
That's awesome.
And it made the show even better.
Oh, that would have been fantastic.
Anyway, back to Pride and Prejudice.
Down Abbey sidebar concluded.
Can we talk about the look of this movie alone,
yes.
The production design, the costumes, the makeup, etc. But I will say one thing stood out for me that I didn't kind of expect. And I think we kind of touched on this when we talked about Atonement last week, Jason, because there were some things in that movie that Joe Wright did that just felt atypical of that kind of movie, just to make it stand out a bit. And it happens in this movie too, because there's a couple shots where, I don't know, it's subtle, but it's like a zoom thing,
yes,
that he does sometimes.
Yes, the 70s zoom that he does, where it's like kind of a quick little zoom, and it's not too in your face, but if you notice it, you definitely see it.
Yeah, I don't know, I can't pinpoint exactly what it accomplishes, but I like it.
Yeah,
I don't know.
I got the feeling that, especially at the when they were doing the big dance scene,
the big sexual tension scene, yes.
Yeah, that we're getting, I think it was helped driving home the crowdedness of the room and then like highlighting a given character, because I got a very claustrophobic sense watching that scene because there is a lot of people packed into that room. And I think even if this were pre-pandemic, I might feel like that's a lot of people crammed into a room, because they didn't care about fire codes in 1812, did they?
Probably not.
No, because that's why the British burned down the White House, because they didn't have a good fire code in place and we were teaching them a lesson.
Well, the Triangle Fire Factory thing hadn't happened yet either.
No,
but that's
no.
In the US, so that doesn't count.
I'm just shocked that this, and we'll get into the Oscars later, obviously, like we always do, but I'm just shocked that this didn't kind of sweep these awards, these categories at the Oscars.
More.
What's that?
Or get more nominations, because there's only four.
Yeah, because I mean, I'm shocked it didn't get, like, you know, costumes, makeup, like, or like cinematography, like you said, like the cinematography is so, it just stands out. And normally when I watch these movies, I'm like, oh yeah, okay, there's beautiful vistas and everything. Like we watched Fire from the Madding Crowd,
yeah.
And we watched like the Go-Between and stuff like that. And like obviously there's nice scenery, it's beautiful at times, but shots wise it doesn't really stand out most of the time. Like it's pretty straightforward, right? Mm-hmm. But I feel like something like this is comparable to something like The Draftsman's Contract, in that there's little things that make it stand out a bit.
Yeah. What a crazy movie. I never expected to like.
that movie is, I mean, thematically, that movie is not similar to this at all. No. But I just mean in terms of, like, I didn't expect in that movie for them to do these kind of wild, like, unpredictable shots, I guess.
Yeah, exactly. You thought it feels like these sorts of period pieces, they could be very standard, you know.
It's also crazy that like a British white dude named Joe Wright made like two pretty solid like movies about romance.
Yeah, he like, knows women. He knows
like
lead
female characters. Yeah. I guess he didn't write them though. So that might be the difference there.
No, Joe Wright was the ghostwriter for Jane Austen. That was his pen name.
Yep, he's 400 years old.
Yep.
other big thing. Well, I mean, other big things I want to talk about. Maybe that kind of big argument scene in the rain between Elizabeth and Darcy, Mr. Darcy, not Darcy. That sounds like a Southern. If you take out the Mister, he just
Darcy.
Sounds like a Southern guy. My name is Darcy.
I believe his first
he turns
name is...
into Foghorn Leghorn.
well, I say, I am Fitzwilliam Darcy, and I'm here to talk to you.
I resemble that remark. But no, that scene is so good. I don't know. I just want to mention that scene.
It's very Chasing Amy.
Yeah.
It's yeah.
Fantastic.
Very Chasing Amy.
Yeah. And it's very well done in basically any version, but I think for obvious reasons, it's the best one because most of them are do pretty much what is done in the book, which is he is like at she's at Charlotte's house. She's visiting Charlotte. And then he comes over and he tells her all this. But like, because Joe Wright is a very smart filmmaker and he got a very smart writer to adapt the work, he instead has her, you know, march out of church after learning this horrible information. And it's obviously pouring rain because it's England. And yeah. And he also follows her. Darcy follows her and is like, I need to tell you that I love you right now. And she's like, I don't like that you're telling me this right now.
Back off, dude. Relax. Yeah.
Please stop what you're doing.
Well, it's the worst timing, but also it's crazy because like you can tell in the scene the acting, it's like they clearly want to like each other. They want to go with this, but there's one thing on each side that's stopping them from doing it. Obviously, you know, Elizabeth doesn't like the fact that she found out that Mr. Darcy maybe told Bingley that Jane might not be into this so much. Yeah. And so her poor sister was, you know, left in the cold kind of thing.
Again, reflecting Darcy's pragmatism and her romanticism, where she thinks, obviously, that you should marry for love. And Darcy is, like other people, is thinking from a practical perspective of who would be a good match for Bingley.
But what I really like, too, is that we do a complete 180, because at first I'm like, oh, fuck, this is going to be a tough thing for him to come back from. I don't like him very much in this scene. But then, you know, once we get the whole thing with like, well, we go back to Wickham and we find out what he did and that he tried to like basically kidnap Mr. Darcy's like 15-year-old sister. And we're like, okay, maybe there's a reason he's a little guarded in terms of stuff like this. Like he's a little hesitant about people saying, you know, oh, they're in love. And, you know, obviously also Bingley has a lot of money, so there's that too. So you get it. You understand him. You don't necessarily think like, oh, maybe he shouldn't have, maybe you don't think like, oh yeah, he should have broken up that relationship, but you still understand his motivation.
You know, when it comes to Wickham, a great American philosopher once said that everybody has a price, and his price, Brendan, is 15 years.
What?
Does that make sense? No?
Wait, was the great American philosopher the Million Dollar Man Ted DiBiase?
Of course, yes. One of America's greatest philosophers.
Right. Professional wrestler and the world's greatest philosopher.
Yes.
I got one more big thing I kind of want to go through, but Sharon, is there any other big like overarching things we haven't even like covered yet? Because there's so much.
I'm trying to think. There's definitely some. Oh, you know who we haven't talked about? Dame Judi Dench.
Yes.
We haven't talked about her at all, and need to.
She's like Kevin Spacey in Seven in this movie, where she just comes the fuck out of nowhere.
Yeah.
I didn't realize she was in it. I must not have been paying attention to the credits. She just shows up, and it's like, yes, here we are. Now this movie's legit.
Yeah, no, I think in some ways this is even better than her performance in Shakespeare in Love. Because she's great in Shakespeare in Love. Yes. But I feel like this is like her, for lack of a better word, bitchiness, like just turned all the way up to 11. Like she says this line to Lizzie at the end in one of my favorite. Like, Lizzie has one of my favorite lines in that scene when she's like, I heard that you are going to be my niece and I am pissed about it. And she's like, okay, I haven't heard this at all. What are you talking about? She's like, did Mr. Darcy propose to you? No. Well, will you deny it? No.
It's a real tete-a-tete, and the thing that really sells that scene too, on top of both actors, is the lighting they give Judi Dench. It's like villain, like horror movie lighting.
Yeah, there's a line where I think I can't remember exactly what she says, but it's something along the lines of, I think Keira Knightley or Lizzie points out at some that like. What is it? She says something like, don't you think that you coming down here would actually convince people that the rumor is true? So you're kind of a dumbass for doing that.
And, people and it's a very get up and cheer moment when she tells her to basically
get out of my house.
Yeah. And she, who knows if a No one's ever talked to me like that. She's very upset. What I think is funny is that apparently when Joe Wright wanted to hire her, like, he had to convince her pretty strongly to do this part. She was very busy at the time. And he wrote her a letter that said, I love when you play a bitch. Please come and be a bitch for me. And she
forgot about that part.
Yeah, she shot everything in she only had 1 week, so she shot everything within that 1 week. So that was the first thing they shot, was Judi Dench's scenes. Isn't that crazy? Like, to get an actor just already at that point, like, Keira Knightley had to be at that level when they shot Judi Dench's scenes, and that was the first thing they shot. That's just wild.
By the way, in my head, my fan fiction head, Sharon, you'll appreciate this, I believe that Lady Catherine is the Dowager Countess's grandmother from Downton Abbey.
Yes. Yeah. Oh my God. That's
She's not as hard as Lady Catherine, but she learned some shit from her.
Oh yeah.
Exactly.
Maggie Smith, Brendan. Dame Maggie Smith. Fantastic.
Ooh. For a while I thought they were the same person when I was younger. Nope, I was younger. I didn't know. They were old British ladies. What am I going to do?
You would watch Golden Girls and you thought they were all the same fucking actress. You thought it was like Multiplicity.
Holy shit, by the way. Remake Multiplicity with Dame Maggie Smith or Dame Judi Dench?
Playing all four roles. Yes,
I don't think I could ever. I don't think that was ever really an issue for me, because I didn't really watch anything with Judi Dench in it until I was much older, and then all the stuff with Maggie Smith I saw when I was pretty young, so I never had that.
You finally saw GoldenEye and you're like, this lady's great.
I think Bond might have been the first thing I saw Judi Dench in, to be
no
honest.
No question for me. No question.
Yeah. But no,
I think
she
might have been my first Judi Dench, because I don't think I saw Shakespeare in Love until after this.
That makes sense. And I only
I didn't
saw
see Shakespeare in Love until like a couple of years ago.
I was going to say, I saw Shakespeare in Love for this podcast. So yeah, no, Judi Dench is great. And I guess I kind of want to compare this a little bit to Atonement. And Sharon, I'm sorry. I know this movie is deep in your heart.
I know.
But I think I do ultimately prefer Atonement.
I get it. They're both going for completely different stories. Yeah. They're both based off of British novels, which I think is very funny. A lot of
they're very similar. A lot of
Joe Wright's works have been based off of something. Not all of them, but a lot of.
And then sometimes unfortunately so. Yeah. Pan. Yeah, sometimes they're
I
pan.
Wanted that to be so good, you
Don't
guys.
Pan,
I
guys.
Wanted that to be so good.
Jason, what do you think? What do you prefer between this and last week's movie?
I felt like there was some more joy in this movie, maybe.
Okay. It's not a plot about a rape accusation.
No,
so.
No, certainly not. I don't know that I could choose one. I think they're both different things and both perfectly wonderful period pieces. I don't know.
So are you going to make Sharon's day right now in saying that you actually really liked a period piece costume drama?
Oh yeah. No, I enjoy them. I mean, they're not, sometimes it's like Far From the Madding Crowd where it's a little long, and much as I love Julie Christie, although I will say this was interesting because this movie definitely had more of an aesthetic that I would place closer to something like The Go-Between, where you have these like very proper manicured lawns and everything, and it comes across as very proper aristocratic, whereas with something like Far From Madding Crowd it felt like a little more natural because they were a little deeper in the country, maybe.
Yeah.
Kind of like Wild Mountain Time, like that kind of feel.
Yeah, exactly. Like the natural quality of Wild Mountain Time, where everyone was Irish
100%.
No one thinks that they're a bee.
No one in this movie claims otherwise, that they are anything but a human.
Well, I don't know, guys. Should we take a break for commercials and then come back for some bits and bobs?
Yes.
All right. Well, I think we're all going to have bits and bobs, right? I'm sure we will.
Bobs
we're
and
all
bits
little notes strewn throughout this strewn throughout this movie.
All four pages of notes.
So we're going to take a little break. We are going to hear for some. We're going to hear. Let me try that again. We're going to take a little break. We're going to hear some ads, and we will be right back.
Age of Radio. I have to pee.
Four Pillar Sports, a podcast for sports fans, made by sports fans. Join Chris and Randy every week as they dive deep into football, basketball, baseball, and professional wrestling. Catch Four Pillar Sports on all major platforms. And remember, keep on talking sports.
great visionary leader of India, Mahatma Gandhi, said, "It is health that is real wealth, and not pieces of gold and silver." Listen to the Healthy Grocer radio show on your favorite podcast platform. We know that health is our greatest wealth, and we will be discussing all aspects of natural healing. Explore everything from supplements, superfoods, and healthy lifestyle choices to help conquer stress and boost productivity. Top industry experts and natural health professionals join us for a deep dive into our healing journey. You can find the Healthy Grocer radio show on demand every day, wherever you listen to your favorite podcasts. And remember, health is your greatest wealth.
Walmart Plus members save on meeting up with friends. Save on having them over for dinner with free delivery with no hidden fees or markups. That's groceries, plus napkins, plus that vegetable chopper to make things a bit easier. Plus, members save on gas to go meet them in their neck of the woods. Plus, when you're ready for the ultimate sign of friendship, start a show together with your included Paramount Plus subscription. Walmart Plus members save on this, plus so much more. Start a 30-day free trial at walmartplus.com. Paramount Plus, essential plan only. Separate registration required. See Walmart Plus terms and conditions.
Bits and bobs. Bits and bobs. Jason. Jason. Jason.
Jason.
Brendan.
Don't interrupt my song.
Bits and bobs. Bits and bobs with the three of us. We're going to read some bits and bobs about the movie Pride and Prejudice.
Jason.
Brendan.
I said don't interrupt my song.
Bits and bobs. Bits and bobs. Bits and bobs.
You're done?
I'm done.
Ooh, one of these days, Brendan. One of these days.
Bang, zoom.
Straight to the moon, bud. Let's see. Bits and bobs. So the first thing I wrote down was, you know, if you didn't know anything about this, and I at least have enough cultural osmosis of Pride and Prejudice to realize it wasn't this, but I would have might maybe assumed that this was like a movie about the world's first female comedy vaudeville duo act, so the Pride and Prejudice. Yeah, let me tell you something. I got a lot of pride. Yeah, well, I don't like you.
You know what? I just think it's appropriate that we're recording this episode during June, during Pride Month.
Pride Month, yes.
Dedicated to the source material, I'm assuming. That's what Pride Month is, right, guys? That's what I...
Here's a question. Sorry, guys.
Oh, well, it is funny that you mentioned that because have you heard of that movie Fire Island that's on Hulu?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, you were saying this, yeah.
Yeah, it's loosely... I found this out. Apparently, Joel Kim Booster has said that it is loosely based off of Pride and Prejudice.
That was literally what I was going to ask you. Is there like a queer version of Pride and Prejudice?
It literally just came out in time for Pride Month.
Nice, nice.
I haven't watched it yet, but I've heard good things.
Well, Joel Kim Booster is very funny.
And SNL cast member Bowen Yang.
I want to promote my album. It's called Music.
I know
that's not the thing that everybody quotes from that sketch, but it was appropriate. So there you go.
Bowen Yang, by the way, was interviewed on CBC Radio the other day while I was at work. And that was a nice interview talking about, I must have been about that movie because I didn't hear it all. I didn't hear all the interview. I was having to serve customers, of course, but.
Jason, one of my notes about this movie is it seems to be a trend of women as commodities.
Yes. Well, I mean, that was really history, wasn't it, for a long time? Like from about, you know, the Middle Ages until, you know, the Victorian era and maybe to today in some ways.
Listen, let me just say something here. Ladies weren't treated so well back then. I don't know if you guys are aware, but ladies weren't treated as well in the 1800s.
What is this?
Have you heard this?
Well, Carl?
Have you heard this? Where are you from? Are you guys married here in the front row? What's going on? Have a good night. That's my time.
Thank you.
Mic drop.
Oh, so here's the thing that made me laugh. So is it Mr. Is it Bigley? Is that his name? Bigley?
Bigley. Bigley.
Bingley. Not Bigley.
Bingley. Like, no. Bingley.
Bingley. Is it Mr. Bingley that assures somebody that he can read?
Yes, he does.
And it's funny because in 1812, assuring somebody you can read, that seems like a reasonable thing to say. If you were to do that in 2022, that's like a really aggressive thing to say. Like, yeah, I can fucking read. What do you think? I'm stupid.
Also want to mention, it must have been a little awkward on set because apparently the actor who plays Bingley was Rosamund Pike's ex at the time.
Oh.
So, and they had to play a romantic couple.
He's married and gay.
Oh, well, I mean, before that, I think he was romantically linked with Rosamund.
No, I know. I know what you mean. I do find that funny, though, because I think I looked it up. He hasn't done anything since, like, 2008, which, like,
that's unfortunate.
Which kind of bums me out. But he seems to be happily married. He's been with his partner for, like, 12 years now, so no. That's healthy.
You know what I think helps this movie a lot, guys?
What's that?
Is the character of Elizabeth kind of taking the piss out of it a few times every now and then. Like, she doesn't let it get so self-serious, mm-hmm. and she kind of, like, prods at it a little bit. It feels almost like we have, like, she's not breaking the fourth wall, but it feels like at times she's like, oh, come on. Mm-hmm. Come on. Come on.
Oh, Brendan, you know what connection this also has to Winter's Tale?
Oh, God. Was Russell Crowe in this movie?
No! Potatoes.
Potato.
Because he makes a comment. He's like, an excellent arrangement and such excellent boiled potatoes. It's been right. such a long time since I had such an exemplary vegetable. Like, what a fucking weird thing to say.
I was watching that scene and listening to his delivery. I'm like, is he just fucking with them? Is he like being like, oh, look at you making this fucking simple meal for me, a prominent vicar? Like, oh, I've not had potatoes like that in forever. That's the impression I got. But no, actually, and then watching the rest of the movie, it's like, no, that's just that guy. He's just a weirdo. He's just a fucking weirdo.
Yeah, he's just a real, real weird little incel man.
Okay, so I have a question.
Yes.
I have a question. Help me out here. So, yep. Bingley in this movie, he's a redhead, right?
Yes.
And I'm trying to think back to all the movies we've watched. Now, as a ginger, I have a certain relation to other gingers in movies. It's a solidarity, if it will. And I can't think of any movies we've watched where the ginger has been, like, the romantic lead. It's always the fucking, like, comic relief or the weird psycho, like in Watchmen. With Jackie Earle Haley.
Jason, did we not cover the Pepper Ann movie yet?
No, we haven't. Actually, now that I think about it, he's a villain in that movie. I was going to say Richard Attenborough in Brighton Rock. But A, oh, yeah. we can't see that his hair is red, and B, he's the bad guy.
I love how you were like, yeah, Richard Attenborough in Brighton Rock. Oh, I guess he's the villain.
He's the bad guy. He's the villain.
Damn it.
There's only subtle clues that he might not be a good guy.
But I'm just thinking, if you could think of a movie where the romantic lead has bright red hair, please let me know, because outside of Chairman of the Board, I can't think of one.
I got nothing. Outside of Chairman of the Board.
Does that count? Isn't he technically the villain in that, too, though?
I mean, he does have a line in that movie that alludes to the fact that he might want to have sex with farm animals. I'm just saying.
Well, I mean, who doesn't? Guys, Jesus.
We're all just not talking about it, guys. Get out into the open.
Oh, what a society.
I want to put out the scene that during that big dance when Liz and Elizabeth and Darcy finally dance with each other and there's no one else in the shot. I thought that was an interesting way to do that, where it showed like they couldn't see anyone else in the room, right? It didn't matter.
Mm-hmm. And my favorite part about that is right before that, it does one of my favorite things, which is when a dance is happening and then the two characters stop moving. Mm-hmm. They're like they're just staring at each other, and then the extras are going back and forth between them. And then it cuts to that, and I love that. I love both of those things combined. It makes it extra, extra good.
Speaking of the dances, I want to say I really loved how when they were doing the dances and they were talking with each other, how they would like pause in between, and it felt really like at that time, if you were trying to have a conversation with someone during that dance, then it would go exactly like that. Because
it's a
you'd
nice comedy beat too.
Yeah, it was funny, but it again feels so real, and I really like that. Also, there's a lot of tracking shots in this movie, like these one long oneers. Mm. Is that what you're called, Brendan? Is that the technical term? A oneer?
A oneer, yeah, for sure.
And they're so well choreographed with the dancing and all the actors and everything. And it's like, wow, it's a lot to people to wrangle. And so I respect that whenever it happens.
Well, again, like Atonement, right? That one tracking shot during the wartime scene. Yeah, Dunkirk.
Yes,
it's just as soon as this movie opened with that long tracking shot, I was like, all right, Joe Wright, I see your kink.
Oh, you know what? This is also an interesting thing to bring up. I'd completely forgotten about this. That this movie is actually kind of controversial in some ways. In terms of the costume design, and especially in terms of the ending.
Okay.
Because, so technically, this movie is not set in 1812. It's set in 1797. Some of that is because Joe Wright thought that it would be more interesting to have the military be fighting in a different war that's not the 1812 war. And some of it was just the pettiness of, I hate Empire wasted dresses. I think that they are uggo. And a lot of people who like the miniseries are like, it's not historically accurate. which I think is hilarious as well, because Jacqueline Duran, who did the costumes for this, and also Little Women 2019, like, she got a lot of shit for both of those because people were like, it's not historically accurate. And I'm like, I don't fucking care. They're nice dresses, okay?
I appreciate that change of setting because it allows the British soldiers in the movie to be wearing tricorns, which I appreciate because I love a good tricorn. I love, like, American Revolution history and, like, British history in that era. And by 1812, I think they probably would have been wearing, I don't know if they're still wearing tricorns at that point. They might have been wearing those weird caps during the Napoleonic Wars. But, yeah, I love that era. It's very historical. But yeah, that's the thing. It's like we're from the Maritimes, and here there's a lot of, like, loyalist history because there were a lot of people that fled the American Revolution and came up here. And so very much a lot of the exhibits and museums and things you go to are very much that tricorn red coat. Oh, God, that's so classic. All for the days when the British Empire ruled the world. Things were so much better. Were they? No, probably not.
What's also controversial about the ending is the fact that the British... In the UK, the Mrs. Darcy scene is completely cut.
Did she headbutt someone?
No. No. I think a lot of Jane Austen, like, fans from the UK were just like, we don't like this. We don't like this. I don't know why. I can't give you a definitive answer. But for some reason in the UK, they probably think, like, because they actually kiss in that scene. So maybe it's the Sense and Sensibility argument.
Yeah. And it's like,
again, I don't know.
It's like some like, I heard there's a whole chapter where she's talking about, she's just having her inner thoughts for, like, this entire chapter about Mr. Darcy. But, like, people got to realize some of that shit doesn't translate well to film. No. Like, it just doesn't. I'm sorry. Like, you could put the whole thing on film if you want, but honestly, I kind of appreciate when I see an adaptation and someone takes a few liberties with it. Like, you know, yeah. Do something with it. If you're just putting the book on the screen, like, what are you really doing? Are you really, like, an artist? I don't know.
Well, and I have heard some people be like, I don't like it because it reminds me of 16 Candles. And to which I say, shut up, because now you're insulting Pride and Prejudice.
no rape scene in this
movie. There's no rape in this, and no one thought it was consensual. Lydia, well, actually, you know what, Lydia kind of counts. Well,
that's kind of, yeah.
Well, but it's back then, you know, 15, different. that was like 30 today. You know, it was a different time.
It was a different time.
It's a different time, and it was fine. That's what I say for every argument. I want to, okay, I know we mentioned the performances earlier, but I do want to go back to just Matthew Macfayden for a second, because not only is he doing the same thing as Rosamund Pike, where he, like, you can't really see what he's feeling, but yeah, kind of still have to see what he's feeling. But his is interesting because he has to slowly make this gradual change in his performance over time, where he starts out, like, very stern and you really can't tell what he's thinking or what he's saying. He just looks annoyed or pissed off at everything. And then as he kind of opens up more, as Liz kind of works him over, so to speak, he gets a little bit of joy in his eyes. Yeah, exactly. Jason's making a humping motion.
No, I was making a punching motion, like working him over, like fucking Mel Gibson in Payback, just kidney punches back and forth.
But he makes a turnaround, and I just think that was another impressive thing with the acting, is that his performance, like, evolves throughout the movie.
So Sharon, as a woman, I need to ask you. We have to talk about what. Because Mr. Darcy, in my mind, based on my osmosis of culture, is one of the great romantic osmosis leads Jones. In any story, right?
Uh-huh.
Is the appeal of him to young ladies like yourself, is the appeal of him his mystery, his sadness, because he has a bit of an emo vibe to me. And
is
I
it because,
like,
he is a sad boy and he is mopey and emo and we want him?
Yes.
That is definitely part of it,
okay.
For sure.
I'm glad that I've... Okay.
I think that's some of it. Some of it is also the, like, as you learn more about him, you find out that he's a very caring person.
Okay, so now I'm going to ask you. So based on that, Darcy doing the right thing. So when he goes and pays for Lydia's wedding and allows this to happen, is he doing that out of the goodness of his own heart, or is he doing that as a way to endear himself to Elizabeth?
I think some of it is he wants to do the right thing, and he thinks that doing this would be the best way to help.
Yeah. Okay.
But also you learn that when he knows how to act like a normal human being, he's actually a pretty decent person.
Yeah.
And he loves his sister basically like a sister. Well, obviously like a sister.
Like you should love a sister.
Like a child. Yeah. Like, he sort of helps raise her because his sister's like about the same age as Lydia. And I think he is actually supposed to be older than Lizzie. So she's kind of like another father figure.
Mm-hmm. I see that. So part of it is that maybe he sees his sister in Lydia and wants to help.
Yeah, because he got very lucky, you know, or him and Georgiana were very lucky that nothing bad actually happened, and that, you know, what happens to that one girl in Sense and Sensibility didn't happen to her. So I think it's sort of a preventative measure there as well.
Okay.
Guys, I know you have way more bits and bobs than I do, so I just have two quick points to make mention. Rosamund Pike having her sudden outburst of emotion at the end of the movie, when she's been pretty stoic throughout, reminded me a lot of Emma Thompson crying in Sense and Sensibility at the end.
I would say, but props to Emma Thompson. That is one of the great performances in history.
Oh yeah, it just reminded me of that because
this is amazing.
It just reminded me of that because they're both so stoic throughout, and then the final thing is just—it's like, whoa, okay.
Like that release.
So when you're talking about her emotional release, do you mean when Bingley proposes to her and she starts crying?
Yeah, the thing that I actually thought about, because I was thinking about Atonement a lot, obviously because we just watched it last week by the same director and the same lead actress, but this movie kind of deals with a similar theme in that. Of like not judging so quickly as well, because a lot of people, you make the assumptions about Mr. Darcy, right? Especially Mr. Darcy. You make the assumptions that Wickham is a good guy from at the beginning, at first, when you see him. You make the same assumptions about, you know, whatever characters. It's not exactly like Atonement, but it just kind of made me think of like, oh, he likes this theme of like misinterpreting people, I guess. Not making quick assumptions about people, maybe.
I do think it's funny that you guys mentioned that because the most recent movie he made was an adaptation of Cyrano, mm-hmm. which is basically the same thing.
Well, I mean, and you think about like what I read up in this movie is that, or on this in the book originally, it was called First Impressions. And absolutely, like the people have certain first impressions of others. And you know, we know in life that can often be difficult to overcome. And that's sort of what we see in this movie, because we see these weird first impressions. Like, obviously, Darcy's first impression on Elizabeth is kind of strange. And she's not sure what to think, but she gets over that. I've got another question here, another thing I want to mention. So who's the youngest sister? And I think she's the youngest sister, the one that when Donald Sutherland, like, she's playing the piano and he's like, oh, all right, that's enough. We can let the other girls play. Is that Kitty?
No. So this is how you know that I've seen this a bunch of times. Yeah. This is the actual order. So it's Jane.
Yep.
Then Lizzie. Yep. Mary, who mm-hmm. plays the piano. Yeah. So she's the middle child, okay. Which explains a lot about her.
Yep.
And then Kitty. And then Lydia.
Okay. So my thing about Mary is that she seems like she's almost a little bit of a proto-goth.
Yeah, especially in this version. She's very much like, she's wearing dark clothing all the time. Like, I'm mm-hmm. going to brood and play at my piano. You yes. know how goths do.
Yeah, exactly. And there's that scene where, like, the other sisters are all tittering about, like, what's going on. And they're like, oh, yeah, so these men. And she's just like, well, couldn't we just have some nice conversation? Like, it's like, oh, are you like goth or are you, like, more religious? I don't know, but you're different than the rest of them. And I like that.
She's not like most girls.
No.
It is certainly like a religious thing too, because they don't really have as much of her, like her ponderingness, but like she's, especially like in the book, she's not as like pretty as Jane and Lizzie, but she also definitely doesn't want to like be like Kitty and Lydia, so she kind of gets stuck in the middle and is trying to be smart like Jane and Lizzie are, but sort of falling short because she isn't as smart, unfortunately. So she does a lot of Mr. Collins pondering, like sort of self-important aggrandizement kind of things, which is why a lot of people think that Collins should have gotten married to Mary. Because they're a perfect match for each other, or, you know, they probably would have been fine.
Well, I'm sure they would have been
but
fine.
But Charlotte's smarter.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I don't know. I think Mary might have had some interesting theological conversations with Collins.
Oh, sure.
I would like to have heard that. I have another question for you as a reader of the book.
Yes.
And I'm trying to, because I feel like something was said in the movie about it, but I'm not sure. What is the deal with Lady Catherine's daughter? Is she a spinster, like an old spinster or something?
Is Anne a spinster?
No, she was wearing black clothes and she had glasses. Is that who I'm talking about?
No, she's not supposed to be a spinster because they mention a couple of times that Darcy is supposed to get engaged to Anne, or that they're supposed to get married.
Okay, that was the thing that confused me. I must have missed something that was said because I saw her sitting there and looking very dour in her glasses, and I thought, who is this lady? What's her deal?
No, she's just kind of like a sad, sickly woman who, like, she's supposed to inherit Lady Catherine's estate and is also apparently supposed to marry Darcy because Lady Catherine and Darcy's mother appearing as Lady, not appearing in this movie, like they had planned them getting married when they were children. And so that's what she's talking about.
So that was what I knew. I knew that he had been promised. I didn't make the connection that those were the same people. I don't know why. Maybe because I'm dumb.
Well, to be fair to you, Anne is not really much of a threat romance wise. So it's pretty easy for her to sort of get shuffled off to the corner. So I completely understand why you would think that and why you would be like, wait, who are we talking about?
Because she get more FaceTime in the book.
No, not really. She gets about as much FaceTime. I think, like, maybe the only thing that I can think of is that, Lizzie finds out about, like, when she sees Anne, she's like, oh, yeah, he's gonna be miserable with her, and that's gonna be hilarious. To me, because she, and this is before she even finds out about the Darcy interfering with Bingley thing.
Okay.
Like, this is how much she hates him at this point. She's like, oh yeah, I'm totally okay with him being married to her because she looks like she'd be awful and he's awful. So he'll just be awful, or he'll just be miserable and I'll be happy.
That's awesome. I have it written down here. Well, first off, Lady Catherine insisting that Elizabeth play the pianoforte. And she's like, no, like, look, it's not false modesty. I literally am not that good at playing the piano. No, you got to do it. Just to fucking try to humiliate her.
I do like that they don't turn it around either. Because I was thinking that she was... It's so true to that character that it really isn't false modesty that she plays, and it's not very good.
Yeah. So Collins, I want to mention another thing I noticed about him that I enjoyed is that when they go to a mansion together or Lady Catherine's place, I think, and he's like looking at everything and be like, oh wow, that's like worth like 300 pounds, and this is like 400 pounds of inlay, and it's like, oh, this is great. A vicar who's obsessed with the cost of everything. That made me laugh. Mm-hmm. What an asshole.
She has a parrot in the background somewhere. It's like, asshole. That sounds awful. I mean, it makes sense because they had all sorts of extravagant animals because they were like, yeah, sure, why the fuck not? They didn't have laws back then being like, you can't keep a tiger in your house, stupid idiot.
The last thing I'll mention, just I want to point out, just because it called back to me, is that Brenda Bledin in this movie is fantastic, obviously. But she's very different than she was in Secrets and Lies. She's not quite to that character level. But the time she comes the closest is when she's lying in bed crying. Yeah. And she just sounds very much like that character. I'm just, oh my God, blah, 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 blah. I loved it. I love Brenda Blythe, and I'm glad we've seen her in this week and last week. And hopefully we'll see her again in the future. I don't know if she's in anything else.
Did we see her in Atonement?
Was she briefly. Yeah, yeah. She was only just a small role.
Right. She plays McAvoy's mom.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
She's very, very little screen time, but she's in it.
Yeah. That's probably why I forgot.
And I heard that in this movie, too, they kind of lower the class down a little bit of the family, which was another sticking point for a lot of fans of the book. And she is perfect for that. No slight on her, but she does that accent so well.
She really is able to portray that kind of social climbing. Like she's aristocratic enough to be in that world, but she's looked down upon by aristocrats. She's the poor of aristocrats.
Mm-hmm.
And they have to kind of, that's a lot to fight against in that society. That weird, by the way, this weird society of aristocrats in the 19th century that do nothing but socialize with each other. And that's the only thing that matters. And that everything is about the social and who knows what, and who's doing what, and who's getting married to who, and when the ball is going to be. It's just so different than now. Where we don't actually talk to other people and we just interact with them online and get mad at them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, I just realized now that Carrie Mulligan was in this movie and I didn't even recognize it because she had very little to do.
Can we talk about Donald Sutherland real quick?
Always.
The British thespian Donald Sutherland. Yes, please.
He's, you know what? I think it's hilarious. Him and Jenna Malone.
Jenna Malone.
Jenna Malone.
Him and Jenna Malone are the only Americans in this entire movie.
Okay, all right. Hold on.
Wait a second.
Donald Sutherland was born an hour down the road from where Brendan is right now. He is Canadian.
Sorry. The only North Americans. They're the only North Americans in this entire movie. But they pull it off really well. Like, I think he isn't really doing, like, a specific kind of accent. She's doing more of an accent than he is, but like the little he's doing, I think is perfect for him.
It didn't stand out as awkward to me. No, like if you'd have told me he was a Canadian actor, I wouldn't have been like, I would have been like, oh, okay. Whoa, crazy. Cause like it doesn't stick out like as a bad British accent by a non-British person.
And I would argue Donald Sutherland is the kind of actor that he's just so fucking good that when you see him in something, he just is. It doesn't matter what he's doing or how he's saying it. He inhabits the role and you buy it.
He carries like that weight of being like Donald Sutherland to every role. Mm. Right? Like it just, he elevates anything he's involved in, I think.
But I think just in general, he has some of my favorite bits in the movie. Like, there's all that stuff where, oh gosh, what's he doing? Where, like, when Mrs. Bennett is, like, talking to him about Bingley coming in, and he opens the door and he goes, good heavens, people.
Yeah.
But I think his best scene is probably the last one that he has with Lizzie when she's talking about, like, you know, I was wrong about him and we're both incredibly similar, and he starts crying because he realizes, like, oh, you're not doing this because you're being pragmatic. You are actually legitimately in love with him, and I'm sad because, you know, you're gonna go and I'm not gonna have basically my best friend anymore, but you're gonna be happy and now you're gonna have a best friend and I'm happy for you for that reason. And then I start crying.
Yeah. Well, that's what's so cool about that character is that you think about, like, Brendan, you think about all the various, like, costume dramas we watched from this era, and parents aren't exactly, like, the best people. And Mr. Bennett definitely comes across as a guy who gives a shit about his girls. Like, he really cares. He really wants to see them happy. And to me, it's reflected especially in that scene where after Collins proposes marriage to her and she runs out and they go out there. And you know, it's like, well, your mother will never speak to you again if you don't marry him, and I won't if you do. So,
which, by the way, seeing when my high school did the production of Pride and Prejudice, when he says, yeah, you basically don't have to get married to Mr. Collins, like my theater, which was literally filled with children, it was just like filled with, we were doing like a student production in class,
yeah,
like it like just a round of applause everywhere, which was amazing.
Nice.
Because it's literally Pride and Prejudice, and you're doing it for teenagers, and they were like, "Yeah, woo-hoo!
Yeah, yeah, you fucking
don't
do
get
it,
married
baby.
To that dick."
Fuck him, yeah.
It's the Oscars cheer moment of
exactly
2005.
So fucking stupid.
All right, guys, are we ready to go into the Academy Awards and talk about that a little bit?
Never. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Let's do it. Let's do it.
All right, now, Jason, I'm gonna quiz you here. Gets nominated for 4 Oscars. What do you think? I know you probably know Sharon, that's why I asked Jason.
Yes, I'm gonna say Best Actress for Keira Knightley, Best Supporting Actress for Brian De Blethyn, Best Cinematography, and Best Adapted Screenplay.
You got Best Actress Keira Knightley nominee correct.
Fuck.
The winner that year is Reese Witherspoon for Walk the Line, which I think deservedly so. I love that movie, and she's great in it. Best Original Score actually went to Brokeback Mountain, and Best Art Direction and Best Costume Design both went to the movie everybody remembers, Memoirs of a Geisha.
So I actually decided to look it up because I was curious about it. Every single person that was nominated for an Oscar for this movie, this was the first time they were nominated.
Huh.
I think it was the costume designer and the art direction, both of them have been nominated 6 times.
Oh, wow. Well, to hell with the Yanks, as we always say on this podcast, because at the BAFTAs, it is nominated. There's a big list here. Oh, it's a pretty big list here. I'll just go through them real quickly. It is nominated for Best Supporting Actress for Brenda Blethyn. The winner that year is Thandie Newton for Crash. It is nominated for Best Adapted Screenplay, which goes to Brokeback Mountain. Best Costume Design, again, which goes to Memoirs of a Geisha. Best Makeup and Hair goes to The Chronicles of Narnia for some reason.
I like it.
But
it's fine.
Weird choice, though, kind of.
I'm not saying it's not.
It's nominated for Best British Film, guys, but it actually goes to a movie that we will
Crash.
Cover eventually. It doesn't Crash, the Best British Film. No, it goes to Best British Film. It's won by a movie that will come up at some point on this list that we're going through right now, and it's Wallace and Gromit, The Curse of the Were-Rabbit.
Oh, yes.
And
that
it wins.
That is pretty British.
Yes.
It's very British.
Extremely.
I mean, go ahead.
That's okay. And it wins 1 BAFTA. Jason, Sharon, if you don't know.
I don't know.
Okay.
Best overall picture?
What do you say, Sharon?
It was nominated for best overall picture?
No, this is the one BAFTA. This is the one BAFTA that it wins.
No, I was asking what
Jason. That was my guess, that it won for best overall picture.
Was it nominated for best overall picture?
I don't know.
I didn't tell you what the last one was yet. I'm just those are the ones it was nominated for. Didn't win, but there's one more, but it did win. So,
You said it was nominated for costumes and makeup.
I did. Yeah.
Shit.
Supporting actress, adapted screenplay, costumes, makeup, best British film.
Oh, maybe best actress.
Cinematography.
You are both incorrect.
Damn it.
But it's a tricky one because it's not a category that we have here. But it won Outstanding Debut for a British Writer, Director, or Producer for Joe Wright.
Yeah, that's right. I forgot.
That's Joe Wright.
That was his first movie?
Yeah.
It was his first big one because I think he had
a TV director before that.
TV stuff at that point.
What
a debut.
Critics for this movie. Critics it's got a high rating on Rotten Tomatoes. It's got like an 86%. So critics were mostly positive. There were, of course, I'm not going to get into because we kind of already talked about the Jane Austen fans that kind of didn't like certain things and whatever. I think some critics claim that the time constraints of the movie made it difficult to capture. They said the depth and complexity of the television serial, and said it was not as daring or revisionist. There was the Jane Austen Society. What is it? JASNA. Jane Austen Society of Not Acting. I don't know. But the president of that society.
Of North America.
Might be North America. It could be. The president of that society said she actually preferred the younger ages of Keira Knightley and Macfayden, saying that Jennifer Ely had formerly been a little too heavy, is what she said, for the role. Peter Bradshaw, the Guardian, said Knightley had an outstanding performance, which lifts the whole movie. But consider the casting of the leads arguably a little more callow than the leads in the 90s version. I don't know. Peter Bradshaw's a weirdo. He does say that only a snob, a curmudgeon, or someone with necrophiliac loyalty to the 1995 BBC version could fail to enjoy Knightley's performance. So I don't know why he compared it to a fucking a dead body. I don't understand that. Critics were divided also about Macfayden's portrayal of Mr. Darcy. Some said they were pleasantly surprised. Some said they disliked his lack of gradual emotional shift, which I don't understand because that's definitely in the book. Or is it definitely in the movie? And they thought, but some people said he matched the insecure and sensitive personality of the book better than Firth. People were pretty much across the board pretty positive about it. This movie cost $28 million to make. Does anyone know what it made?
I would say $94.7 million.
$104,075,000.
$121.6 million.
Price is Right rules. You win, Sharon.
I win. That definitely covers the debt now, I'm sure.
No.
Damn it, Jason. You realize that the
goals.
You realize the danger when you guys are placing bets. Did you put all of Sharon's money on the line that she owed us?
Oh, man. Look, let's not talk about that. Let's talk about the movie.
Well, we're done talking about the movie pretty much. I just want to get your final thoughts. So, Sharon, as our guest, I will allow you. That sounds so bad. I will allow you to go first. I will get you to go first and tell us So you like this movie?
Obviously. I think it's probably I know it was definitely my first version of Pride and Prejudice. Saying that it's the best, I think, does it a disservice because almost every single version of this story, including the book, has its own merits. It has some disservices as well, depending on how you adapt it. Pride and Prejudice has some stuff in it I don't like the fact that Darcy's a touch on the racist side a little bit, just a little bit. He does some light racism. But it's still my favorite. I own that shit on Blu-ray for a reason. So, yes, this is one of my favorites for sure.
All right. And Jason, what did you think? This is your first experience with this movie. I got nothing. What do you think?
I really like this movie a lot. I enjoyed Sense and Sensibility, but I think this is a better movie. I really enjoyed the performances. I love the actors. There was a lot more fun, I think, in this movie. I came to really like Matthew Macfayden as Darcy in the course of it. And, you know, as far as costume dramas and you know, adaptations of classic British novels, it's pretty hard to beat this. I think if you were going to read the book in school, maybe you'd probably watch this one if you didn't want to read it. Maybe it's not fully accurate, but it'd get you there.
Yeah, and I mean, it has that that kind of fun, breezy air about it that a lot of these movies similar to this don't really have. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, it makes a lot of them a little bit of a I'm not saying like I hate any of them or even dislike them, no. But it does make some of them a bit of a struggle to get through.
Yeah.
I think we talked about this last week with why we both liked Atonement a lot is because there's a lot more forward momentum. Mm. It feels like we're getting somewhere. It feels like with, again, and I hate to mention this movie for the 18 millionth time, but Far From the Madding Crowd or like Go Between, it's just like, we're just kind of, I feel like we're almost going in circles at times. And I'm like, all right, let's get to the next plot point. Let's do this. Why is Far From the Madding Crowd 3 hours long? But anyway.
It's the stiltedness of it.
Yeah, I think so. I think this one just, and I get it. That's like, it's a product of its time too, when it was made. And like a lot of movies like that were, you know, were acted like that at the time. But there's just so much fun and the performances are so good. The writing is good. the writing is good. It's Jane Austen. And so, yeah. As someone who like has little to no knowledge of this stuff, I had a good time with it. I enjoyed it. It was fun. Thanks, Sharon.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Yeah, that's wonderful. We probably wouldn't have watched this movie otherwise. So
we were trepidatious. We were like, oh no, what if we hate it? And Sharon will be so mad.
But I'd rather watch this type of this movie than, you know, than Far From the Madding Crowd or
yeah.
Go Between. As much as I love Julie Christie, those movies are slogs in comparison to something like this. Mm-hmm. It just really gets there. Feels
I feel like the remake of Far From the Madding Crowd might be better, but I can't remember. It's been a hot minute, so I could be wrong.
And it does have Pride and Prejudice's Carey Mulligan in it.
Exactly.
I almost said Peter Bradshaw. I was going to say Peter Sarsgaard, but I don't think that's right either.
What if Terry Bradshaw was in Pride and Prejudice?
Oh, shit, with Carey Mulligan?
Yes.
That's some chemistry.
And Gary Elwes as Darcy.
Michael, oh my gosh, what's his name from Tyson. Twilight?
Michael Imperioli.
Sheen.
Michael Sheen's in it. He's great.
Okay.
He plays great. The George C. Scott character.
Patton?
No. The George C. Scott from Far From the Madding.
Oh, okay.
The villain that he plays in Cartoon All-Stars to the Rescue? That George C. Scott character?
Was George C. Scott in Far From the Madding Crowd? Wasn't that?
No.
Peter
Finch.
Peter Finch, yeah.
Oh, sorry.
Terrence Stamp is in it too.
Yeah, no, he plays the guy from Network. I
Peter
forgot.
Finch.
Peter Finch. I almost said Peter Cushing. I'm like, nope, that's wrong.
Oh, if only. Oh, God, wouldn't that have been amazing if Peter Cushing had played Peter Finch's role in Far From the Madding Crowd?
He did play Mr. Darcy. In a version. Yeah. But unfortunately, according to Wikipedia, that version has been lost to time. So
that was one of the ones that was probably wiped by the BBC to save tape.
Yeah, I think because it was like in the 50s or 60s, so probably.
Yeah. Well, there you go, guys. Pride and Prejudice 2005. We did it. Sharon, thank you for coming on.
Thank you.
And Jason will
My
pick
debt
up
is definitely wiped clean now.
Yeah, well, as I say,
stop mentioning the money, Jason.
I was going to say that Jason will pick up your check on the way out, but he just lost it in a fucking poker game, basically, here. So good job, Jason.
I may have made an error, Brendan.
Error of judgment. Do you have
anything?
That's
why you don't fuck with me.
Do you have anything you want people to check out, Sharon? Like Twitters, Facebooks, Instagrams? No?
Nah, I'm good.
Stay away. Stay away from me.
Is there any brand of snack you'd like to plug?
No. No, just stay hydrated and, you know, take care of yourselves. We got monkeypox out there and mm-hmm. COVID's still a thing. So, you know, just take care of yourself, stay hydrated, do all the good things to yourself. Take care of yourself, promote self-care.
But if one positive thing can come out of it, all those creepy YouTube channels where people are like, hey, let's make out, they're all going to get monkeypox. So
thank God.
Yeah.
So now that we are done with this Brit pick, Jason, you are presenting us with a Canuck Puck next week,
yes.
A Canadian film that you want to talk about. Why don't you tell us what that is?
This is a movie Brendan and I saw many years ago, and I'd heard about it, and I think I caught it on Showcase one night when it was on. It's a Don McKellar film, a Canadian legend, Don McKellar, and it is called Last Night. And Last Night is a story that takes place at the end of the world. And how people deal with it. And I believe in the movie, spoiler alert, it's never actually revealed what the end of the world is, but it's how people are dealing with it. And I'm excited to see it again because it's been a long time. It is a fine piece
Sandra
of Canadian. Sandra Oh, yes, and Don McKellar. So we're going to have some fun, I think.
All right. Yeah, it sounds really uplifting.
Oh, absolutely.
All right, so there you go. Next week, we're going to talk about Last Night. That's an interesting sentence. And of course, you can find us on all the podcast apps. Our home base, of course, is Age of Radio, ageofradio.org/forscreen.
And Gundre.
You can find us on Facebook. Just search for Forscreen.
And Gundre.
And on Twitter, we are FSAC Pod. That's Forscreen.
And Gundre.
Podcast. And Jason, where are you on Twitter these days?
I'm still hanging out, Brendan. I'm over at Jason D. McLeod. That is M-A-C-L-E-O-D. Proper way. Fuck anybody that spells it M-C. You're pretenders. So come on by and fight me.
You got the same handle on Truth Social, or is that different now?
I got banned from Truth Social for mentioning January 6th. So, I'm not there anymore. But Twitter, I'm there.
They only talk about facts on there, Jason. What you mentioned is fantasy.
That's true. I only read Ben Shapiro on Truth Social.
Oh, fuck everything about that. So, yeah, I guess that's it. Again, Sharon, thank you very much.
Thank you so much. It's long overdue. Thank you so much for coming on. You have really made these two gentlemen much better people for your presence.
Oh, thank you.
And you have helped us also. We are glad to have you here too, because a movie like this, if it was just Jason and I, we would not hear the end of it from people.
There would have been so much TikTok.
You fucked that up. You fucked this up. You don't know what the fuck you're talking about. So thank you for being the Jane Austen expert on this.
Oh, thank you. Jane, and by Jane Austen expert, we mean someone who's read the book once.
That's right. That's
or
right.
A couple of times.
Pride and Prejudice expert.
Sure.
But Jason, I guess that means we're talking about last night, next week. It's weird to say that again every time
last
I do it.
Last week tonight with John Oliver.
That's what we're doing next week. We're talking about every episode of Last Week Tonight with John Oliver. It's going to be a really long episode. But until then, I guess I just have to say to you, Jason, God save the queen.
God save the screen.
And for Screen and Country, I'm Brendan.
And I'm Jason.
Oh, and also I'm here.
Bye.
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 Prejudice.
I'm so in love with you. Whatever you want to do is all right with me. 'Cause you make me feel so brand new. Spend my life.